in Dubai, you know, they are actually distributing water by donkeys. You know, because Al Ghurair told, Al Ghurair, they are one of the richest people there in Dubai. But these guys, they have the guts and they think big. And that's why they're there. Why they are, you know, you can see, yes, it's Dubai in 2008. Economic crisis, if you look at it, at that time there are more than 3,000 cars in Dubai because the economy was so bad, people were just driving the cars they took on credit and running out of the country because, you know, they were throwing into jail. So, but today, it was a different story. I remember I was passing on to China in 2008, and when I passed through Dubai, honestly, there was nobody in that airport. But that did not really stop them from building their Terminal 3, which is almost ready. And that Terminal 3 is only for Airbus 380, the double-decker, you know, aircraft. And we had dinner on Sunday. Yeah, Sunday. You know, we had a dinner on Sunday. I was with a friend, the Al Ghurair guy. So he said, well, let's drive to go. He's been invited for dinner. Okay, I won't mind. I'll come with him. We went to the chairman of Sheikh Ahmad, you know, the chairman of Emirates. You know, so we're just having a chat. In the discussion, you know what he told me? He said, I don't know, right now what they are doing in Dubai, you know, they're investing over $500 million in infrastructure. Hold a minute, say, yeah, every month. Yeah, every month. Average $6 billion a year, that's what they spend in infrastructure. And that is really what you do, what you think. You know, I mean, it's not a rocket science. And that is why when you look at a place like China, that's what they did. Because you must plant something before you can reap anything. Because China, when they started this, 20 years ago, they are not, China was nothing. But they kept investing in infrastructure, infrastructure. For the past 15 years, nothing but infrastructure. Today, somebody was, the same former president, I was telling him that, you know, the cement China uses is more than the whole cement of the world combined together. Yes. The total cement used in the world is about 4 billion tons, out of which China uses 2.18 billion tons. And they are not stopping. They build their roads. Because once they build a road once with concrete, that's it. They don't, you know, they go to another area. So the road infrastructure, and up to now they are still building more massively. You know, the DG of Unido, yesterday he was in my office from 7 to about 9. We had a meeting and dinner. And we are discussing about these issues, about this. He said that, well, you know, you realize that in the next, by 2000, and by 2030, there will be 40 million people in Lagos. I said, yes, I do realize that, but I think it is also good for our leaders to realize that we will be 30 million in Lagos. Because if we get to 30 million in Lagos, we are still using the same 1976 bridges. We won't move to anywhere. So we need to make sure that we look into infrastructure, because that's really what can show for us. So we decided that we find what we need to do to also reduce the cost of doing businesses by having a deep sea port. A deep sea port, because you know today you can have one ship carrying 12,000 containers that they can just go and drop. But there is no market in West Africa that can take 12,000 containers. Maybe in the interior, but even if you do that once, then you don't need another ship for maybe another 1 month or so. So what you need to do is to have that massive port where you now come and dump the containers. Then you have smaller ships that will take to the other smaller ports. Because all the other ports, they are small. And you know, and once we do that, fine. So we've been talking to the government for the last couple of years, but the two governors now, Ondo and Boko very, very serious, and we're almost there in terms of building the draft pillar. We want to take over draft pillar and build 18-meter draft box, which will serve Nigeria and also the other West African units. So we want to be 2,000 megawatts. With this, it will actually help to expand the this, because that's really what it is. In Africa, you don't need a register. There are so many things, the opportunities, they are there. You know, that's what will keep inspiring all of us. Because, you know, in areas, just like what I wrote in this Financial Times, you know, when he said that, you know, the story of, you know, visiting someone that I saw people not wearing shoes. You know, it is an opportunity. If you go to an area where people are not wearing shoes, it means that yes, there's an opportunity for business. And you know, that's really what it is. And these opportunities that they are just too much. And what I keep telling people, you know, people really don't appreciate where we are coming from. And that's why really, if they do appreciate, I believe we'll be thanking God every second. You know, because the opportunities that we have here, they are quite a lot. But obviously, you know, you have to use your brain to make sure that you harness those opportunities. Because they're there. You know, I mean, today you are living in a place where you have 100 and almost 70 million in terms of population. And you have another market of 140, which you can add to your phone. But if you look at it today, there's even no Nigerian company really that's looking at this advantage of other ECOWAS markets. Because it's huge. It's a total of over 300 million market. And there's nobody that can joke with this kind of market. Why do you really want to go if you want to invest if it's not ECOWAS? The North African side, they are a little bit saturated because of their nearness with the European business, and also they have issues today because of what? Because most of those countries, you know, they have about 60-70% unemployment in the bracket of youth. So, and there's no country that will have that kind of numbers and they live in peace. No? So, yeah, that's what it is. You know, I mean, it's only a matter of time. So when you look at these things, you know, you add them up and see that, yes, we still have. But honestly, despite all lapses, this is the great country on earth. I've never really seen opportunities like what I've seen here in Nigeria. Questions and answers, you can also ask me, and I can confirm to you why I'm, you know, thinking. Go to the next page. These are some of, at the group level, these are the you know, management team that we, you know, have. We have a couple of more people coming because we have expanded now the business. Our business is going to go towards more export-oriented, like what I've, you know, mentioned to you. And, the areas, you know, we have the building materials, cement operations, and here the international. And then we have a steel company. You know, we have a shop we haven't started yet. There are reasons which I said. Then we have the food, you know, side, which is the milling, the Savannah sugar, then the sugar refinery, which we are trying to combine and then transform in South. What we have done now, I'm sure some of you have read in the media, you know, even if you have maybe it's better I say so that you know. The food side, what we are trying to do, we know that yes, it's true, going forward, even in Africa today, 73% of our income goes to food. It's not our bracket, but the lower bracket. And we know that yes, it's very important. But you see, the size of the new businesses that we are trying to do are so huge and it needs a lot of our time to talk to the management and concentrate. And we don't want to be an FMCG company, you know, first-name consumer goods. That is very difficult. We can never ever be like Nestle. It's not because no, we can't do it, yes, we can have it, but it is a little bit of a headache for us, you know, to do that. The kind of businesses that we want are the big tickets business, you know, where we will go, you know, you have, it's not that we don't really, we don't mind competition, but we want less of competition. We don't want a business that you have 10 people doing the same business. And, you know, it's better I tell you my own experience. When you have a business that you have 10 people doing the same business, you might have to be losing money for some time. Because sometimes people don't add their numbers. Sometimes, for different reasons, somebody wants to just dump the goods to quickly go and pay off a bank. So there are several issues with that. And I think we rather concentrate on the big scale. So on the sugar, the flour, the salt, what we are trying to do is to get partners that will sell off part of our shares and give them the management so that we can use our time to put in the infrastructure, petrochemicals and mining. Because we have a mining business which we are trying to because we have actually understand the mining business very well today. And we prefer to have all our cement factories in Nigeria are actually mining between 80 to 90,000 pounds of raw material every day. And that is, we have two massive ships that we did in 45,000 pounds. And the maximum ship you can bring that is 45,000. So maybe if you are doing that, it's 45. But why are we looking for taking export? Because Nigeria is not known for export of solid minerals. Yes, it's true, because we don't have a port. But if you can do a port, red line would almost be cost for an individual. But you see, if you take the old red line to where the past, like maybe you can gear off and do it in the port. So that you can take the distance. You don't have to do a full line, but you can use part of the government network to be able to take part. And that's why Nigeria has massive reserves of solid minerals. But because there's no port, nobody is looking at that. So I keep saying that in Nigeria, what God has given us, we actually don't really know. We have no fuel at all. I mean, you take, for instance, gas. Nigeria is actually a gas-based country, not an oil country. But unfortunately for us, we have not invested money in gas industries. You know, and when you look at it today, if you take a car today, more than 60% of car today is all plastic. It's coming from plastic. So, and gas prices have so, by now, when you look at the prices of gas, they are just about $2 per million BTU. And this was something that was coming from 13. So it means that yes, today it does not make any commercial sense for us to do LNG, to go and export gas, because of the US shale gas. Gas is so cheap. And there's no need for us. So what we need to do is quickly to go and hide and do gas industries, all these petrochemicals, but everything you can do with gas. Even the gas, it is gas that you use to crack, and also have methanol. Now you know methanol, you can use 10% of methanol into any liquid, whether it's aviation fuel or something, without changing anything, up to 10% maximum, you can blend. So they can do quite a lot with gas, and that's what I believe that we should do in Nigeria, to be able to broaden the base of the revenue. You know, because we are increasing, the population is increasing by 3%.